So Stephen, how are you doing today?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm good. How are you?
Yeah, going very well indeed. Good. We're obviously doing these recordings to build the Marshall White Way and a standard philosophy of taking approach. And one of the things that you're absolutely fantastic at is the whole preparation around your auctions. So let's have a chat about that. And I guess firstly, start out with a very simple philosophy that you have around your auctions.
Yeah, really simple, Michael. Know your buyers, know your vendors, know your strategy, and make sure everyone understands it. It's really clear. Yep. Get that right, you'll be fine.
Great. And when everyone understands it, you mean everyone within your team that's involved in supporting you in the whole auction process?
Yeah, absolutely your team, but your vendor needs to know where your buyers are at, and your buyers need to know what they need to do on the day. So again, all comes back to that strategy.
Yeah, fantastic. So around knowing the buyers, some of that would have happened throughout the open homes, open follow-up and so on. But at the pointy end of auction prep, are there any conversations you specifically have with those buyers that have expressed serious interest in the property?
Yeah, of course. So firstly, you need to know what they've been bidding on. You need to know where their capacities lie, where they see the property, of course. Most importantly for me, because I'm an auctioneer, one of the roles as an auctioneer is to resell the property. I like to make sure that we know what specifically is important for these buyers in this transaction, whether it's about the home itself, whether it's about the timing, because they've got kids starting school in 2 months' time and they need to get it settled, so that when I'm out there, we can resell these particular things to those buyers when they're good. In the midst of decision making. So you need to know those things.
Could be the area, could be, you're looking for the nuances to be able to reinforce that come auction day.
Absolutely. You know, when someone's at the end of the bidding process and you can just get that little jab about the reminder that there's been no single level homes available in this proximity to the shops for the last 3 years, surely that's worth another 1,000 or 5,000.
Great scarcity, great positioning, sort of a uniqueness with it, well and truly.
Yeah, absolutely.
And what I love about that is you're taking those buyer interests and bring it into your positioning of the property actually on auction day.
Absolutely. Anyone can do a generic resale, but the generic resale is done for the neighbours, it's done for potential listings, it's not done for the bidders on the property. If you know what's important for buyer ABC, what the demographics are, why they were attracted to this, your resales have massive value. Massive value.
Absolutely. Yeah, huge. And there's a particular question you ask those buyers.
Oh, look, there could be any number of them, but for me, it's really about what's important in this property to you. What do you love about the home?
Yes, yeah. You were also mentioned before we started recording.
The question, something like that.
the question, what's important to you about this transaction?
Oh, yes, of course.
Yeah. That one.
Yeah. I don't ask them that so much directly, but I make sure that we understand it. So, as I said, if they've got kids starting school at the start of the new year and there are only two auction weekends left, we know that that's absolutely important to them. If for them it's about affordability and they've only got X amount to spend and there's not much in that marketplace, again, we need to know that information.
Absolutely.
Whether it's a downsize and this is the only one that's had absolute single level without a step, we need to know that information.
Fantastic. As well as that, any coaching with the buyers about where they need to be positioned?
Yeah, absolutely. So we'd like to position them on price firstly, but I think equally importantly, we need to make sure that they know what they need to do on the day to show their strength to other buyers. I will always talk about...
Great dialogue, by the way.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. No, it's absolutely true. Well, when I kick off an auction, I'll always start with, I'm happy to place a vendor bid, but if you want to show your strength, show other people that this is your home and you're here to buy, I'll welcome them in. So again, if you have this conversation with people beforehand, show them what the buyer's advocates do in terms of kicking off strongly, maintaining strong bids, not breaking me down on the way through, testing themselves on how far they'd go well ahead of the auction so they know exactly what their absolute walk-away price is and they can bid strongly in big increments up to there. If you coach everyone in the same manner, then there's no doubt on auction day you're going to have a great auction.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Likewise, fantastic. If you know that it's only the one bidder, you need to make sure that they need to know that they're going to be that they need to hold that bid if it passes in. So again, you've got the negotiation set up.
Yeah, fantastic. So how about I be one of those buyers, interested parties, and you give me a call?
Absolutely.
It's over the phone?
Yeah.
So I'm not going to look at you because we're on the phone.
Great, I won't look at you either.
Hello, this is Michael.
Oh, hi Michael, it's Stephen Smith from Marshall White. How are you doing?
Stephen, I'm very well indeed.
Good, Michael.
We're at the pointy end of the conversation, aren't we, in this deal?
We are indeed. Have you got a moment to talk, Michael?
Yes, certainly.
Beauty. Look, I just wanted to call and wish you well for Saturday's auction.
Thank you.
Now, have you bid at auction before, Michael?
Yes.
That's right. I remember you said you'd bid on 32 Halifax Street previously.
Yes, correct.
Is that correct? Great. Yep. Okay. Have you bid at auction with us?
No, not at a Marshall White auction, no.
Okay, great. Well, Michael, I'm going to be the auctioneer on the day. So if you've got a moment, I'll just sort of give you a couple of tips because we like you and we'd love for you to be able to buy the property. You've got to be the person who's willing to pay the most, of course. But would you like a few tips to...
Yeah, sure, that'd be great.
Okay. Well, Michael, one of the great examples I use is if you look at the buyer's advocates. Have you seen buyer's advocates bidding at auction before?
Yes, I have seen them on the odd occasion.
Well, you'll always notice the advocate will stand in a strong position. They'll bid absolutely strongly the whole way through. It leaves the impression with the other buyers like they're just going to keep going forever. Now, the key to that, Michael, is to make sure that you test yourself. You know, if you've got 1.8 in your mind, you know, maybe is it 1.8? Is it 1.82, 83, 84? Whatever that number is, you want to have absolute clarity on the way in as to how far you'll go, and then just bid strongly the whole way up. Now, the reason you do that, Michael, is if you've got someone else there who might be thinking that they're a 1.8 buyer and they might stretch a little bit. Once you start to show weakness, you're only going to encourage that. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Beautiful.
Absolutely.
Beautiful. Michael, thanks again for coming along. We're here to help. We've already confirmed your settlement. What was it about this property that, for you, it was the you're downsizing, aren't you?
Well, downsizing and also school zone. So it's a combination of those two.
Yeah, fantastic. Because your kids are starting at Brighton Grammar next year.
Yes, that's right.
Beauty. So yes. So in terms of settlement, you want to be in before the school year starts. Is that right?
Look, that would be ideal. We could do a transit in the short term, but the ultimate would be to be in there. Yes.
Oh yeah. Oh yep. Look, with traffic, who'd want to be travelling, huh?
I agree.
Very good. All right, Michael. Best of luck for tomorrow. If you've got any questions, give me a call anytime, and we look forward to seeing you then.
Okay. Fantastic.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
Yeah. Now, you wouldn't ask if I want any support on auction day?
May do.
And certainly what the essence you got on that call.
Yeah. We'll usually start these conversations well in advance, so I don't leave it until the Friday beforehand.
Yes.
We'll have covered all of this off in the days and weeks leading up, whether it's me or whether there's a more appropriate fit within the team. It might be that we've got a female colleague or someone like a second agent who they feel the most comfortable with.
Great.
So we'll be well prepped. And certainly on the day of auction, I'll always let people know that the team's here. If they come up beside you, it's because they're really competitive and they want to win. And if they're beside you, they want to help you. So take comfort in that.
Yeah, great. They want to help you win.
Exactly.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
Great. So that's a good knowing the buyers and also coaching them on where they need to be. So I love that dialogue. It was fantastic.
Yeah.
Also, your energy is great on those calls. So I think that's a big part of it.
Yeah.
And the reassurance that hang on, the auctioneer is calling me to go through that process. That's also quite neat.
Yep.
To transition. Obviously, some of the guys haven't got that ability because they're following up a campaign and someone else is auctioneering.
Yep.
So still the same process.
Yep.
But maybe even that person could do a bit more of a third party sell on the auctioneer and how great they are in that process.
Yeah, absolutely. And an introduction on the day before the auction to the key buyers goes a long way to giving them comfort and establishes some rapport before we kick proceedings off.
Yep, fantastic. So that's a great from a buyer point of view. On the vendor side of things?
Yep. With the vendors again, your vendor needs to know who the buyers are and what the appropriate strategy is on the day. Now, I always talk with vendors about the possibilities of what can happen on the day of auction, whether we've got no bids, one bidder, multiple bidders not quite at the reserve, or multiple bidders above. And we have the dialogue then about which one of those will depend on who's there on the day and what their thoughts are on price. If you don't know where your vendors are on price, you can't get the appropriate strategy in place.
Right, okay. So hopefully during the campaign, we've been doing great feedback and positioning people as to where things are sitting around price, the vendor. You've started to allude to them what the strategy might look like.
Yep.
Someone much stronger than everyone else, or you think it's going to go very well, but they've all got to turn up on the day for that to happen. So there's still a question mark until we actually get to auction day, well and truly. Great. And I like those three scenarios.
Yep.
Would you then talk about, so if scenario one happens, here's the strategy, scenario two happens, here's the strategy?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I can give you the dialogue if you like.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah. So I'll always sit down and talk with vendors about the four possible outcomes. Option one, we go out the front, we call for bids. Nothing happens.
Okay. Right.
And usually someone will fill in the blanks for me at that stage, which is a nice little icebreaker into it. Of course, if we get no bidding, we're placing a vendor bid. If we're passing in on a vendor bid, we go inside. If we get to a price that you're happy with, negotiating with whoever may be there, we sell away. Otherwise, we're back Monday night.
And we move from auction conditions to a different mode.
Well, no. We're still within those 3 business days of auctioning, which is important.
Yes.
But we make it very clear that if the price that we put online afterwards is appropriate, we'll get some great traction. If no one calls, if no one comes along, then we know we need to reassess where we're at and very quickly before we get stale. So that's option one. Obviously, that's our least preferred option.
Yep.
Option two, we go out, we call for some bidding, we get one party bid. We may or may not place a vendor bid. In my experience, if we get one party bid, we want to pass it in quickly to them. The last thing you want is to be out there for 10, 15 minutes calling for bids. You bring the buyer inside and they say, well, Stephen, you did everything you could. Clearly, it's just me. So we get them inside quickly and we start the negotiations. Same process. We get to a level they're happy with, we sell away. If we don't, we don't. Option three, we go out, we get some good competitive bidding. Now, either we don't quite get to our vendor's reserve, or option three, we go out, we get some good competitive bidding, but we don't quite get to our vendor's reserve price, in which case we're simply passing the property in, grabbing the highest bidder, bringing them inside and negotiating as much more as we can.
Yeah, and you've done some coaching with the buyers about making sure they're in a position to be the person that we're negotiating with if we pass the property.
Absolutely.
Yep.
And when we're standing out the front, we make it absolutely crystal clear that we are only negotiating with the highest bidder. Only. So there's real impetus. Our buyers going into our auctions are very well coached. They know exactly what they need to do. And our vendors know that they know what they need to do.
Fantastic.
Option four, of course, we go out, we get some good competitive bidding, we get comfortably above the vendor's reserve price, we put it on the market, gets the vendor out of the way. It's no longer buyer versus vendor, it's buyer versus buyer. And that's where the magic happens. Now then we go on to talk with the vendor about which one of those four strategies will depend on who's there, where their price points are at, and where the vendor's thoughts are on price. And that leads us then into the price conversation at this final sort of point in time.
Mm-hmm.
It's important then that the vendors know what's likely to happen. If the last thing you want is a vendor expecting that it's going to be on the market, when you know that this auction, the purpose of this auction is to set up one buyer to bid and then we're bringing them inside. If you're really clear on your strategy, what the auction's about on the day, are we setting it up for a private sale? Are we getting ready to pass into one buyer? Are we looking to get it on the market? Then you can execute nicely, and the vendor needs to know which one it is or which ones are likely.
Yes, yeah. And look, even potential, there's a buyer that hasn't got their finance in place or that needs something else. They're probably the buyer for your property, but they're not going to buy under auction conditions.
Yep.
Let's look at where we go with that as well.
Yep, absolutely. Yep. Or if we've got one buyer, you know, we might need to be talking about other potential buyers who are looking to buy subject to FIRB, for example, who can't buy under auction conditions, so you've got to make sure you hold the bid.
Yes.
Got to make sure.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Fantastic. Great.
Good.
And then on a team awareness point of view,
yep.
When are you doing that?
Oh, I think on a Friday, it's important to set out who's got the best relationships with the buyers, who needs to be standing beside which buyer, obviously who's getting all your boards and all that sort of stuff done, who after the auction is going to the buyer, who's going to the underbidder, who's going to report to the vendor, who's documenting up, and what the conversations that we need to have are. So everyone needs to know their role in it so you have this seamless flow.
Yeah, so very professional. It's not an ad hoc kind of process on auction day. It's very, very structured. People know what they're doing, know how they're going to add value to the process.
Yep.
And it will clearly look more professional and also will flow far more effective.
Absolutely. And particularly if you're having negotiations, and you know at the moment we're having a lot of negotiations after auction,
yes.
You need to know who's going to be the lead voice with the vendor, who's going to be the lead voice with the purchaser, you know, and who's going to be that third man up if you need that extra voice afterwards.
Yeah, fantastic. Stephen, this has been awesome talking about the preparation. So back to knowing your buyers, knowing your vendors, knowing your strategy, and making sure that the team are well and truly educated in the whole process.
That's all it takes.
Thank you so much.
Thanks,
appreciate
Michael.
It.
Good on you.
Excellent. We'll be right back.